stay up here.
This is a night for contemplation. There is little rejoicing this night. The time of learning and testing is at hand. Strengthen us and give us courage, O Lord. Amen. The opening prayer is in the hymnal on page 353. O God, maker of everything, and judge of all that you have made. From the dust of the earth, you have formed us. From the dust of the dead, you would raise us up. By the redemptive power of the cross, create in us clean hearts, and put within us a new spirit, that we may repent of our sins and lead lives worthy of your calling. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our opening hymn is number 395, Take Time to Be Holy. We'll sing the first and last of number 395. Please sing.
And I hope that you will join me in that journey. As we begin this season of Lent, your call to begin the journey is this. It's a quote from one of my favorite people, Pope Francis. And he said, "During this Lent, let us all ask the Lord, Lord, make our hearts like yours." Let's begin the journey of Lent.
We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As God's fellow workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain, for he says, "In the time of my favor I heard you, and in the day of salvation I helped you." I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. We put no stumbling block in anyone's path so that our ministry will not be discredited. Rather, as servants of God, we recommend ourselves in every way, in great endurance, in troubles, hardships, and distresses, in beatings, imprisonments, in riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit, and in sincere love, in truthful speech, and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness, in the right hand and in the left, through glory and dishonor, bad report and good report, genuine, yet regarded as impostors, known yet regarded as unknown, dying and yet we live on. Beaten and yet not killed, sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, poor, yet making many rich, having nothing and yet possessing everything.
Our second hymn is number 530, "Are You Able?" We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4, number 530.
Are you able, Savior, to save? Do we receive thy grace? Our second scripture lesson is Psalm 51, 1 through 17. Be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness. According to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in the innermost being, and in the hidden part you will make me know wisdom. Purify me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will be converted to you. Deliver me from my blood guiltiness, O God, the God of my salvation. Then my tongue will joyfully sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, that my mouth may declare your praise. For you do not delight in sacrifice, otherwise I would give it. You are not pleased with burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. The word of God for the people of God.
Now, we've had a game going on in our house, and I'm not sure that really anybody knew what was going on except for me. The game takes longer to play now that the kids are gone and we're empty nesters, but trust me, the game is still in full swing. There's really not a name for this game, but let me explain to you how it's played. First off, you pull a new, large kitchen trash bag from the box, and it unrolls just like that. And then you take that bag and you fling it so it fills with air. Then you walk over to the pantry and you take the fresh, clean bag, and you put it down into the garbage can. And sometimes it takes some work because you might get a vacuum or something there, and the garbage can isn't always real receptive to receiving its new liner, but it will be done. The next step is you close the pantry door. Now that's a step that the people in my house, or the players, if you will, of this game, don't always do. They oftentimes forget that part of the game. And that kind of drives me crazy. But back to the game. The next part of this game takes some time. And the reason is because there's no set timeline on this game. It all depends on how large or bulky the game pieces are. The bigger the pieces, the less amount of time it takes to get to the end of the game. Okay? You see, the goal of the game is to see just how high emptying the trash. You'd be surprised at just how high trash can be piled. I mean, no kidding. I have seen red Solo cups perched on top of green bean cans, which are nicely wedged between a empty waffle mix box and a carton of milk. It's astounding. You'd be surprised that if you use a little bit of strategy and careful placement of your game piece, you could win. It's sort of like playing Jenga. Do you know the name Jenga? It's like Jenga, except that it's the opposite. In Jenga, you try to pull pieces out without having the tower or the avalanche happen. In this case, in this game, you're adding pieces on and trying to keep the trash from overflowing. And it's hard to determine the winner of this game because you never know who the person just before you was. The loser, though, is a cinch to identify. You see, the loser is the one who causes the crash, the avalanche, the trash to overflow, or if they're smart, they throw in the white towel and say, I give up, and they take the trash, they mush it down, because you know it's already stacked up to here, so they mush and mush and mush, and then they start wrestling this bag out, and it's so full, it's jammed against the can, and another vacuum has happened, so you find yourself holding it with your feet and pulling with everything you got, and finally you get it out. You tie it up, and you drag it outside around the corner of the house and plop it in that big green monster. Now, as odd as that sounds, and as odd as this is going to sound to you, I think that silly game reminds me of life. And it especially reminds me of life in the season of Lent. I think you'd have to agree with me, there is lots of garbage in day-to-day living. Our trash can take a variety of forms. Sometimes our trash is anxiety. We worry. We stew. We're concerned and worried about our children. We worry about our finances, our marriage, our work. We worry about whether we should get out or the streets safe if it's been icy. We worry about our health, our parents' health, our children's education, the government, violence on the streets, and world peace. We worry. We're anxious. Sometimes the garbage, though, the garbage takes the form of anger. Getting mad. Some of us have a fuse about this long. Maybe you get angry at the car that slammed on the brakes right in front of you and you almost nailed. Or maybe you get angry at the lady in front of you who's trying to juggle a toddler and an infant and pay for her groceries and she's wasting your time. You've got somewhere you've got to be. Or maybe you're angry at children. Children being children, children disobeying. Or maybe you're angry at that coworker. The coworker who's not pulling their weight or carrying their share of the burden at work. Sometimes that trash takes the form of guilt, regret, feeling bad about things. Maybe you regret bad decisions you made when you were younger and less wise. Or maybe you regret the way you handled a situation with a family member or a friend just yesterday. Or maybe you regret missed opportunities. Chances that you let slip away that might have made a difference in somebody's life. Because
because you were busy or you were going to be inconvenienced. Sometimes our trash is fear. So many things can make us afraid. Fear of losing your job. Fear of being alone. Fear of getting out and becoming a victim of crime. Fear of a worsening economy. Fear of losing your health care. Fear of the demons that sometimes bind you and blind you. Fear of the future for your children and your grandchildren. Anxiety, guilt, fear, anger, those are just a few. Those are just a few pieces of trash that we burden ourselves with in our day-to-day living. And the thing about this is it piles up, just like the game of the garbage can. It accumulates day after day, and it adds up to this untidy pile, and it weighs down your spirit. It clutters your thoughts. It contributes to a pretty rotten mood every now and again. And it piles up and up. The empty waffle mix, the green bean can, the red Solo cup. Up, up, up. And you're barely able to keep it together. And other times that precarious balance is lost. And that causes a really big mess. Friends, Lent is the perfect time to take out the trash. It's a time for us to face the reality of the trash we have in our lives, be it the ones we mentioned or others. Because it takes a terrible toll on us individually, on our health. It takes a toll on our families, our community, and even our world. Lent is a blessed time. It's a time of reflection. It's a time to slow down and intentionally focus on our spiritual journey. Think about it. Spend time thinking, reflecting, because you can't change the course. In Lent, we're called to examine our hearts and our minds. We're called to examine our entire life as it relates to God. Are there areas in our lives that are burdened down under a pile of trash? Are there things that we should empty out, take to the big green monster, and just let go? Lent is a blessed opportunity. We are called to turn back to God. Turn back, repent, and to weave faith into those places where the trash was. We're called to repent, change our hearts, and when we do, we're renewed. Reflect, repent, and renew. And Lent is a blessed paradox. You know, sometimes during Lent, we fast from something. I've had several conversations over the course of the day. What are you giving up for Lent? Fasting from maybe certain things you like. Certain foods, chocolate for one. That's a favorite for people to give up. Desserts. Caffeine. That didn't work so well for me a few years ago. Facebook. Television. Whatever. But the thing about it is, when you give that up, you should replace that with time with God. And you receive something
that you didn't even know you needed. I called it a paradox because what's odd is you take something on, this new relationship with God. You've got something new you're carrying, a stronger, healthy, more intimate relationship with God, and the load gets lighter. That's a paradox. The journey through Lent is a way for us to humbly go before God, holding in our hands the trash that we need to empty. It's a way for us to confess our total inadequacy before God, to completely strip ourselves bare of all pretenses and fake appearances, to come before God with our trash in our hands, bare, vulnerable, raw, and marked with dust and ashes. During Lent, oftentimes people focus on spiritual practices. They invest themselves more in time of prayer and reflection, meditation, reading the scriptures, fasting, as we said, self-denial, self-discipline. What we're doing is completely opening ourselves up to God, laying it all out there, coming naked before the Creator. And what's cool is God will not just take away the garbage. He will not take that trash from your hands. He's going to replace that with peace and joy that comes from the presence of the Holy Spirit. When we can recognize and respond anew to God's presence in our lives, that's emptying the trash. During Lent, we place all our needs, our fears, and our anxieties, our failures, our disappointments, all of your trash, as well as your hopes and dreams, your very lives themselves, in His hands once again. And that process, it begins tonight. It begins in ashes. And it journeys through the wilderness. It journeys through darkness. It's a 40-day spiritual journey that I am convinced that all of us must make one way or another for genuine spiritual renewal to come and for us to truly rejoice on Easter morning. We have to have traveled through the wilderness. Won't you please join me in this journey? Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the early Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's passion and resurrection. And it became the custom of the church that before the Easter celebration, there should be a 40-day season of spiritual preparation. During this season, converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism. And it was also a time when persons who had committed serious sins and had separated themselves from the community of faith were reconciled by penitence and forgiveness and restored to participation in the life of the church. In this way, the whole congregation was reminded of the mercy and forgiveness proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus Christ and the need that we all have to renew our faith. I invite you, therefore, in the name of the church, to observe a holy Lent by self-examination and repentance. by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and by reading and meditating on God's holy word to make a right beginning of repentance. And as a mark of our mortal nature, let us take a moment. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that these ashes may be to us a sign of our mortality and repentance, so that we may remember that only by your gracious gift are we given everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Begin this journey tonight in ashes. I would invite anyone who would like to receive ashes to come forward. You can receive them on your forehead or on the back of your hand. If you'd like them on your forehead, if you'll come back, come and with your hands behind you, I'll know. If you want it on your hand, if you'll extend your hand. Thank you. that is confession. I would invite you to join with me in our prayer of confession as printed in the bulletin. O God, when we pause to look back at our lives on this Ash Wednesday, we realize that we have been weighed in the balance and found wanting. We have neglected to do good when it was in our power to do so. Forgive us, O God, for the times we have neglected to provide our children, our community, and our world a true example of Christ-like love. As we begin the journey of these 40 days, wash us, O God, and we shall be clean. Cleanse us, O Lord, and we shall be made whole. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. Almighty and merciful God does not desire death for sinners, but instead desires that we turn from wickedness and live. Accept your repentance, forgive your sins, and may God restore you by the Holy Spirit to a newness of life. Amen. Accept these gifts. Accept these gifts from our hands that are also holding the trash that we are going to present to you. These gifts made in love. Gracious Creator God, in this moment, perhaps we feel speechless. We have so much we need to say and so much we need to share, but yet we need time as well. We thank you for the gift of time. We thank you for the gift of these 40 days where we can be intentional. Intentional about thinking and reflecting about who we are and whose we are. We thank you for a faith community that can gather together and begin this journey one with another. God, in this night, we lift to you people who are suffering, people who are ill, friends and family who face surgeries and complications, and Lord, those who grieve. We lift all of these, lift them to you, and pray that your Holy Spirit would surround and just bring peace and comfort. God, as we enter these 40 days, I ask that you would guide our steps, guide our thoughts, help us to truly experience Help us to keep our eyes on the cross, so that at the end of the day we may celebrate a new life. We pray all these things, Lord, in one voice, as one family, as we pray our prayer that your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
I am.
Begin in the dust, and we walk through the desert and the wilderness.